Thank you. We'll now move to the final item of business, and I would ask those members who are leaving the chamber to please do so quickly and quietly, as we are now back in session. Thank you. The final item of business is a member's business debate on motion 10307 in the name of Megan Gallagher on maternity services in Scotland. This debate will be concluded without any questions being put, and I would ask those members who would wish to speak in the debate to please press the request to speak button. I call on Megan Gallagher to open the debate. Around 7 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And can I begin by thanking those members and, of course, those in the gallery who have stayed on tonight to take part in a wider discussion about maternity services in Scotland. It is greatly appreciated. Although I am shocked not to see Colette Stevenson, because she did want more time to debate this issue, and this would have been the ideal opportunity for her to participate in the debate. Because having not one, but two debates on the same issue shows how strongly MSPs feel about maternity services being removed or scaled back. As I mentioned earlier, the SNP does not have a good track record when it comes to maternity services. Since 2016, this government has downgraded or closed maternity or neonatal services at Caithness General Hospital, WIC, Dr Gray's in Moray, University of Wishaw General, Ninewells Dundee, Victoria Hospital, Fife. Expectant mums and newborn babies up and down the country have been impacted by these decisions, with many starting up campaign groups to voice their anger and frustration. This chamber has heard the issues that rural mums face when travelling over 100 miles to give birth in hospital, especially during the harsh winter months. There have been many debates on this exact issue, but we have yet to see maternity services fully reinstated at either Caithness or Dr Gray's. And what I find staggering is that over 90% of children born in the Caithness area were delivered at Regmore Hospital in Inverness, despite there being a maternity ward in Caithness General. And the process for a mother going into labour in these areas is even more questionable. The general instruction is to get in the car, and when you're having contractions, that is no easy task, with your partner, if they happen to be with you at the time, and travel 105 miles down the one and only road to Inverness, the A9. This road is the exact road this government has failed to dual, and they seem to think that it is safe for mums to give birth at the side of the road. Once the expecting mother arrives at the hospital, they admit themselves to the maternity ward at Regmore, and that is if it's time to admit, as mums will understand contractions doesn't automatically mean admission to hospital, and any false alarm would result in a 210-mile round trip. So does the government seriously think this is a comfortable and acceptable journey for women suspected of being in labour to make? No expecting mum should ever have to face a journey like that, but yet it still happens. Campaign groups in the Highlands have rightly been angered by this, and it appears that they have been given no support by this government to provide them with better maternity care. They have been forgotten about by this government, and the SNP should feel ashamed of the journey rural mums need to make to give birth in a maternity ward. Presiding Officer, the reason I brought this members' debate to the chamber today is because I am a mum. And when the news broke about Wishaw General Hospital neonatal department being downgraded, I couldn't sit back and let it happen. Because I gave birth to my own daughter there just over a year ago. I met the wonderful midwifery team at the hospital. The care and support that they give to families and newborn babies are second to none. I couldn't understand, and still don't understand, why Wishaw General or any of the other areas were selected for downgrading. But that's part of the problem. This plan to reduce the number of maternity services in Scotland has been shrouded in secrecy, and many questions have been left unanswered. In the case of Wishaw Neonatal, babies who need specialised care could be transferred to either Glasgow, Edinburgh or Aberdeen, the three major cities, instead of being closer to home. And for the benefit of those saying that Glasgow might be close by to Wishaw General, if it was Aberdeen, that's roughly 150 miles away from Wishaw. What message is that sending to mums who are already going through an exceptionally stressful time that they will need to make a substantial journey in order to access specialised care, when the care that they could receive is actually within the hospital they're due to go to. It makes absolutely no sense. And as Monica Lennon said earlier on, make it make sense. The Minister spoke about a fund earlier on that parents can access to help with costs for travel and food. But I must say, £8.50 is not going to get you that far if you have to travel to Aberdeen. It's centralisation for centralisation's sake at the expense of vulnerable mothers and babies. Has the government thought about how traumatising it could be for a new mum and baby to be put in an ambulance and told that she needs to go to another hospital, all because the one that she is currently in can no longer help them? I get the Minister said that journeys would happen before Labour started, but babies don't always work that way. And as we heard in the case of Mark Griffin and his family, there are cases where it would not be safe to move a mother or baby. And I do thank Mark for sharing his story, and I understand why he's not able to take part in the members' debate this evening. And let's not forget, we're talking about giving support to babies who need it most. Surely this should be delivered as close to home as possible. Then, of course, there are the logistics. Will the midwives be required to work within several different health boards? If a mother and baby need to be transferred, will the midwife have to accompany them, resulting in less resource within Worcestershire General, when that's already stretched to breaking point, as it already is? Finally, there has been a shocking lack of consultation. The announcement came out of the blue, and this was the reason why a large group of concerned women are here this evening, because they won't stand for it, and nor should they. Presiding Officer, I have enough time left to thank those who contacted MSPs widespread about this issue, especially Lynn, who is at the forefront of this campaign to stop the neonatal department at Worcestershire General from being downgraded. Lynn has her own story about her son, Innes, and I've loved seeing photos of him since he appeared on a BBC documentary highlighting the wonderful support he received during his stay at Worcestershire General while receiving specialised neonatal care. It's because of Innes and other babies that we will fight this decision every step of the way. Because Murray mums fought the downgrade, Caithness mums are still fighting the downgrade, and Lanarkshire mums, we're the feisty type, and we will fight this decision every step of the way. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Gallagher. And I now call Emma Harper to be followed by Douglas Ross. Ms Harper.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I welcome that Megan Gallagher has secured this debate, and I note the degree and the detail in regards to Dr Grace and Caithness Hospital that she described. And I do want to remind Chamber that I am still a registered nurse, and I was a former clinical educator who did provide specific clinical education support for midwives in NHS Dumfries and Galloway. I do agree with the member that it is important that expectant mothers are able to deliver their babies as close to home as possible, but this must also be clinically safe and the right option in each case. And as the Minister will know, I have a number of challenges when it comes to maternity services in Wigtonshire and Dumfries and Galloway, and I will focus on some of these. Presiding Officer, when mothers have to be transferred further from home to receive the best care for their baby, it is crucial that support is in place to enable parents to be at their baby's cot side as much as possible. And I'm aware that the Scottish Government is committed to improving maternity and neonatal services in Scotland to ensure that they provide the right care for every woman and baby and give all children the best start in life. We've heard in the previous debate that I sat through, as well as tonight's debate, in 2015, maternity services underwent a national review through which the Best Start grant, a five-year forward plan for maternity and neonatal care in Scotland, was developed. And in February 2017, the Scottish Government appointed the Chief Exec of NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde to lead the implementation programme board that will implement the five-year plan. Implementation of the Best Start programme was remobilised in May 2022, following a pause due to the COVID-19 pandemic. The plan for maternity and neonatal care in Scotland updates and builds upon Neonatal Care in Scotland, a quality framework published in March 2013. However, while I welcome this work, my constituents in Wigtonshire are not able to deliver their baby locally at Galloway Hospital in Stranraer. This means many expectant mothers who are not able or who do not wish to give birth at home are required to travel 72 miles to Dumfries Infirmary in order to deliver their babies. And in 2011, the Clenagh Birthing Centre at the Galloway Community Hospital, it was operational as a community midwifery unit, providing low-risk midwifery-led intrapartum care as a two-bedded facility. And in 2018, due to the sustained and significant staffing pressures, the operational decision to temporarily suspend the birthing centre at Clenagh was taken by NHS Dumfries and Galloway, and the centre is still closed. Thanks to the campaigning from expectant mothers, the Galloway Community Hospital Action Group and others, NHS Dumfries and Galloway commissioned a review of Wigginshire Maternity Services, which reported in July this year. The independent review of maternity services in Wigginshire has been published initially, and the review has the support of the Community Maternity Hub at Galloway Community Hospital. They want to see the Community Midwifery Maternity Hub returned at the hospital. The hub would provide an on-call intrapartum midwifery unit. Lots of constituents have long campaigned for the return of a local midwifery service and midwifery-led service unit in Wigginshire. And this does include the Galloway Community Hospital Action Group, which I have worked closely with, and the previous Minister for Public Health met with the Galloway Community Hospital Action Group along with colleagues in Stranraer. And I understand that if the service is to be resumed, that changes will be required in the current Clenagh Birthing Centre, including an upgrade in the facilities and equipment with projected cost of £103,000. And the report says that staff will also require updated education in obstetric emergencies before maternity services can properly resume. These recommendations are a step forward, and I thank everyone involved in carrying out the review. I do acknowledge that the safety of mothers and babies is of paramount importance, and expert clinicians, doctors, midwives, anaesthetists must be involved not only for their clinical input but able to be recruited and retained for the service delivery to be achieved safely and returned at Wigginshire. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Harper. I now call Douglas Ross to be followed by Richard Leonard. Mr Ross.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I congratulate my colleague Megan Gallagher for securing this important debate, and also welcome the campaigners from Wishaw General Hospital who are here for two important debates today and continue to fight for what they believe, and I believe, and I think hopefully most of us in this chamber believe is the right outcome for them and the local area. I want to focus my remarks on Dr Gray's Hospital and the maternity services there, because I was astonished during the debate to hear the Minister basically patting herself on the back to see how good things were now in Moray, because we have this pledge to reinstate consultant-led maternity services by 2026. Let's just remember, they were first temporarily downgraded in 2018, and the government weren't thanked for the fact that they may get back up and running by 2026. But crucially, the Minister visited Elgin back in August, just a few weeks ago, and after the meeting, Kirsty Watson, who I was in contact with last night and today ahead of this debate, and others in Keep Mum are frustrated by the lack of progress. We are getting no answers from NHS Grampian, we're getting no answers from NHS Highland about how this consultant-led unit will be introduced, and the responses from the Minister, both on the 24th of August and in subsequent letters, is to say everything is fine. Don't worry, this service will be back up and running. Well, I can say, Minister, we are worried. We are desperately worried in Moray that there is no progress, no real progress being made, and it is having an impact. Now, I want to use my time today to articulate in this chamber a very difficult birthing story, because I think it's really important that the Minister hears this, because this is happening to Moray mums right now. It has been happening since 2018. In the past in this chamber, explained my own family's story. But this is one that I think should shock the Minister and hopefully shock the government into action. This mum spoke about her first baby being born in Dr Gray's in 2020. And the downgrade did worry the family about having another child, but they did, and things were going well. But then there were last-minute complications, and I'm just going to read exactly what the mum put into the public domain. I was told I had to give birth in Aberdeen. On the morning that my contraction started, I phoned Dr Gray's and was advised to make my way through to Aberdeen ASAP, as it was a second pregnancy, and because of this, they wouldn't turn me away. We drove through, and I was contracting the whole way, which was horrible. When I arrived in Aberdeen and was examined in triage, I was told I was only 2 centimetres, so would need to go home, as women labour best at home. The mum explained that she was from Elgin. It was a four-hour round trip and it wasn't possible just to nip back home for the labour to continue. She then says, they then advised that we would need to book a hotel as we couldn't stay at the hospital as they didn't have space. So we frantically tried to find a room to book and managed to get one just down the road from the hospital, but check-in wasn't until 3 p.m. By this point, it was only 12 p.m. We asked if we could stay at the hospital for a few more hours and we were told no. She continues, I was then contracting heavily in the hotel car park. My waters had gone and were leaking everywhere. And I was crying my eyes out, feeling so scared and uncomfortable. I phoned the hospital back around 2 p.m. and explained that the contractions were a lot stronger and closer together and asked if I could come back in, but they said they didn't have space for me and I could only come back in at 3 p.m. So I waited another hour, and by the time I got into triage and was examined, I was 78 centimetres and my baby was born 30 minutes later. She finishes by saying the whole experience was awful and felt inhumane. I had several panic attacks throughout and afterwards, and I still feel panicked when I think about it now. Minister, this is happening right now in Moray in Scotland, and it is unacceptable. It is inhumane. So we must ensure that consultant-led services are reinstated to Dr. Gray's as quickly as possible so no more mothers and no more families have to suffer in the same way as this.
Thank you, Mr. Ross. I now call Richard Leonard to be followed by Graeme Simpson. Mr. Leonard.
Deputy Presiding Officer, can I remind members of my membership of the GMB Trades Union, which organises NHS workers, and I suppose in the idiom of Douglas Ross, I ought to record that my wife is a serving trade union organiser for NHS workers. Can I also thank Megan Gallagher for bringing this important motion to Parliament? In so doing, she shone a bright national parliamentary spotlight on a dark plan to centralise and downgrade nationally critical, locally based neonatal services. Like her, I'm especially concerned about the threat hanging over the neonatal intensive care unit at University Hospital Wishaw, which is proposed to be downgraded from level 3 to level 2. One midwife, an experienced one, Elsie Snedden, told me, I quote, and Minister, these are the clinical experts as well. She told me this would not just be a disaster for Lanarkshire, but a disaster for Scotland. Greater Glasgow and Lothian patients are often transferred into Wishaw, so why take it away? 4 weeks ago, I wrote to the Cabinet Secretary setting out some of these concerns. At the time, there were 10,000 local signatures on a public petition. There are now over 12,000 signatures on that petition. At that time, there had been no consultation with the public, no consultation with the trade unions, no consultation with anyone based in Lanarkshire, and shockingly, no consultation with families who have direct experience of the neonatal intensive care services at Wishaw. And all of these weeks later, I have to report that there has still been no consultation, even though the proposed downgrade could have profound implications for patient safety. Even though every staff member I speak to who delivers these services tells me of their anxiety and concerns for infection control and risk, for neurodevelopmental care and outcomes, for family-centred care, for staff retention and staff transfers, and for ambulance demand and capacity. But there appears to have been no real assessment of any of that, no equality impact assessment, no risk assessment, no assessment, let alone an independent validation of the data sets used, no assessment of the co-location of specialist paediatric services on site at Wishaw, no assessment of the skills, training, and irreplaceable institutional knowledge which is now at risk, no assessment of the impact this is now having on staff morale, no assessment of the human cost, no assessment. We are told to follow the evidence, but this whole exercise has lacked transparency. There is no breakdown of the weighting of the scores in the options appraisal report. Widespread concern, too, that the statistics used are way out of date. Now, it's the government's job to consider the best available evidence. So I say to the minister tonight, do not rely on the tables in this report. Listen to the human stories of the lives which have been saved, the futures which have been won, the hope that has been given, and do not extinguish that hope. Finally, there are risks in service redesign, risks in this so-called new model, in over-centralisation, risks in cutting the number of beds, because that's what this means, risks in the downgrading of our local NHS services. And if we haven't learned that over the last few years, we've learned nothing. It's time, Minister, that you stepped in, stop this plan, finally listen to the voices, including those here tonight, who need to be heard. This is the right thing to do. It's the only thing to do. And that is what we are calling on you to do tonight.
Thank you, Mr. Leonard. I now call Graeme Simpson to be followed by Monica Lennon. Mr. Simpson.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. I've listened to the previous debate and this debate with interest. The Minister was not prepared to take any of my interventions earlier. I will take any of hers if she's prepared to make them, because her contribution earlier was, in my view, tin-eared. She wasn't listening. I say to the Minister, she has an opportunity, even now, to say that she will reconsider, she will pause this, because the vote, she's won her vote earlier, but it is not binding. She can change her mind. She could say, as she closes this debate for the government, that she will reconsider and she will go back to the drawing board, and that is exactly what she should do. I have to, of course, congratulate Megan Gallagher for securing this members' debate in the first place. It should not have been necessary. The plan to downgrade the neonatal intensive care unit in Wishaw has managed to provoke the ire of patients and staff, and as we've heard earlier, has attracted 12,000 signatures on a petition which the government is apparently ignoring. It would see babies requiring specialist care taken to Glasgow, Edinburgh or Aberdeen from Scotland's third largest health board. Now, the staff at Wishaw are not just among the best, they are the best. They're the best in the UK. Here's what one of them told me. Quotes, Wishaw neonatal unit are currently a level 3 unit, successfully managing care for the babies of Lanarkshire effectively, confidently and to a high standard. Our multidisciplinary team won UK neonatal team of the year in 2023, and our care and success was evidenced on the Tiny Lives documentary. We successfully manage our workload with a highly competent and skilled team of staff. It's a concern that downgrading will mean that we should stabilise babies that we are skilled at caring for and transfer them to another hospital to the detriment of staff, babies and families. I query how this is child or family-centred care and propose it's financially or politically motivated and based on inaccurate data. Close quotes. Deputy Presiding Officer, this has been a deeply flawed process. The Scottish Government consultation falls short of being fair and inclusive, and it was in no way transparent. Decisions were made by the Scottish Government without representation from Lanarkshire on the board. No one from Lanarkshire. Other boards were fully represented. Why was that? Perhaps the Minister can tell us that. She can intervene on me now and explain that. She doesn't want to intervene on me. NHS Lanarkshire representation on the perinatal subgroup involved in this was only there until 2019. Before the options appraisal process started, there was no local representation after that. Data within the document is no longer relevant and was in fact relevant only in 2015. The scoring system used has been called into question. It weighed heavily on the ability to provide interventional care for rare congenital anomalies, but most of these are picked up during pregnancy and plans put in place for delivery. However, Wishaw has specialist fetal medicine expertise for just this purpose. This move could, will, have a detrimental effect on NHS Lanarkshire, who could lose skilled staff to other areas. It's happening already. We heard that in the previous debate. It could see mums move to other hospitals. Now, having a sick baby is a hugely traumatic situation for any parent. We heard Mark Griffin speak movingly earlier on. It's completely senseless to move them from their local area, their support network of friends and family, ask them to leave their other children if they have them, when care is appropriate locally as it is. This isn't a plea or a campaign based on just wanting to keep something local for the sake of it. We're not saying this decision should be revisited because it sounds good. It's because it's the right thing to do for staff and crucially for mums, dads and their babies. The government must think again and don't palm us off, as the minister tried to do earlier, with focus groups. That doesn't cut it.
Thank you, Mr. Simpson. I now call Monica Lennon to be followed by Finlay Carson. Ms. Lennon.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I too want to thank Megan Gallagher for securing this debate and bringing everyone together tonight. And I want to join her in paying tribute to all those campaigners and families in Caithness and Moray and indeed in Lanarkshire, which I will focus on in my remarks. I know that Megan Gallagher feels this very personally as a mum who just gave birth to her baby girl in Wishaw just last year. My daughter was born in the same hospital, not last year, but 17 years ago. And a few years ago, Richard Leonard and I had a really lovely special visit to the hospital so we could go there and meet staff and listen to them, those working in maternity and in neonatal. And on that visit, to my surprise, I was reunited with my midwife, and she gave me the biggest hug, and I was just very kind of humbled that she remembered me. But it was a lovely, lovely chat, because I mentioned in my speech earlier on that for those families who've had the experience in neonatal, it does feel like family. They do feel that there is genuine love and compassion and care, and that continuity of care is really important. I made the mistake of sitting behind Mark Griffin earlier today. It was very moving. I agree with Graeme Simpson. And Mark and his family have been so open about their struggles, and that has helped other families, particularly in relation to the financial support that Mark's campaigning helped to secure. But we've heard a lot today about mitigation, the support people might be able to get if this goes ahead. We can prevent this trauma from happening, and that is the whole point here. And Mark Griffin has had to leave for this debate. Rosa needs picked up from rainbows tonight, but I think we'd all welcome that, and we wouldn't grudge Rosa her rainbows experience. The Minister knows that I chaired the cross-party group on women's health. I'm very passionate about women's health. I make no apology for that. But I think the points about the impact on women, the birth trauma that Douglas Ross has addressed, there's so many issues here that affect women, but also dads, partners, family units. And it can have lifelong impact. It doesn't need to be like that. And I have to say, I'm quite jealous of Jenny Minto. She's probably got one of the best jobs in government to be the Minister for Public Health and Women's Health. But you're sitting there as a lonely figure tonight, Minister, but we don't want you to be alone with this. We don't want you to be burdened with this terrible dilemma. People want to help. The people in the gallery want to help. Our communities, they know what they're talking about and they want to help. And I have to say, I would quite like Richard Leonard to be the minister that's looking at this, because he went through things forensically. These are the questions that ministers need to ask of civil servants and clinicians. We have to be forensic. We have to get to the bottom of this. And I think Carol Mocking earlier on was very, very clear about this. She hit it on the head. Where is the transparency? You know, where are all the documents? NHS Lanarkshire were not even properly at the table. And that's a point that the Royal College of Midwives have made in their briefings. There's not a lot of time left, and I hope that Colette Stevenson does ask her business manager to get a proper debate in here, because parents in the gallery tonight have messaged me and said, what does this actually mean? What did that vote actually do? Well, that vote was to endorse the downgrading And that's not what people want. And we're going to live to regret this, Minister. As we've heard from some of the families that have been mentioned throughout the afternoon, there can be significant long-term complications linked to prematurity and babies who need that neonatal care. Being able to go back to your local hospital and see those familiar faces, to have that institutional knowledge that Richard Leonard talked about, money can't buy that. So yes, it is a dark plan. This downgrading will be dangerous, but it's not too late, Minister. We can stop it. And what I wanted to ask when the Minister didn't take interventions earlier on is, when did the Minister last go to University Hospital Wishaw? When did she last visit the neonatal unit and speak to the staff and try and walk in their shoes and try and understand? Because you can't sit behind a desk or in this Parliament and write them off. Please listen, they are award-winning for a reason.
Thank you, Ms Lennon, and I now call Finlay Carson. Mr Carson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Firstly, can I thank my colleague Megan Gallagher on bringing this debate to the Chamber. As we've already heard today, the Scottish Government appears determined to downgrade or even remove altogether vital maternity services across the whole of Scotland. Their actions in some cases is putting expecting mothers unnecessarily at risk, especially those living in rural communities such as my own in Galloway and West Dumfries, who often face lengthy journeys because there are no neonatal services close by. Born in A75 may sound like a dodgy rip-off of the classic hit by Bruce Springsteen, but sadly, it's no laughing matter, because on this occasion, it's become a reality with women having to give birth in lay-bys along the A75. Indeed, I know of one child whose birth certificate lists her arrival as Drumflower Road End, Dunragget. That's simply unacceptable. Now, I don't want to focus on the risk associated with A75 because I know that the paramedics and the midwives that accompany these mothers, left with no option but to make the 70-mile journey, they provide the highest level of care, no matter where. But we simply cannot continue to have the situation where one new mum said she'd had to travel 7,500 miles during her pregnancy to get maternity care. There are mothers who have told me that they would not have any more children because they could not face the uncertainty of possibly having to make those kind of journeys, and the sort of journeys that Douglas Ross has described. The fact of the matter is that increasingly mothers-to-be are being denied a choice of where they can give birth. A normal, natural, physiological birth within their own community with their support network around them should not be denied to any woman. Whether it be in Dumfries, in Stranraer or at home, they have the right to make that decision and not dictated to because of a flawed management decision related to workforce decisions or downgrading maternity or neonatal services. The Minister will be aware of the campaign to reinstate the midwife-led Clenoch Birth Centre in Stranraer, a campaign led by mothers, elected members and the Galloway Community Hospital Action Group. And it's resulted in an independently led review of maternity services in the west of Dumfries and Galloway. It was led by NHS Ayrshire's and Arran's Crawford McGuffey and Jennifer Wilson with the support of midwifery expert Angela Cunningham. The two proposals were drawn up, the existing model of a community maternity hub with home births and a second option which also included planned on-call birthing for low-risk births at the Galloway Community Hospital's birth centre. The recommendation from this independent group was option two, but bizarrely and frustratingly, the IGB haven't, as a matter of urgency, put in place the plans to deliver what this independent inquiry has recommended, and I would call on all IGB members to do the right thing. The Scottish Government must support local NHS boards to improve work planning, retention and recruitment, particularly given the huge demands on our much-valued midwives, who now have increased responsibilities and require an increased set of skills, and that's required particularly in rural areas. Everyone wants the best care for mothers and babies, and the move to ensure that the smallest babies are looked after in centres that will have the right level of care is not disputed. But the Royal College of Midwifery has voiced concerns surrounding the testing of the government's model following the publication of the 5-year forward plan on neonatal services. But we're in a very different world from 2017, when the Best Start was published, both demographically and financially. Now, the ethos of Best Start is care close to home and keeping mums and babies together and to individualise care around the needs of women, their individual circumstances and their family circumstances, and that's certainly not what's been offered in the west of my constituency. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, I want to stress again that fathers and mothers-to-be must be given a choice when it comes to giving birth. After all, Minister, this should be the most, one of the most, if not the most precious moments in our lives.
Thank you. Excuse me, Mr Carson, and I now call on Jenny Minto to respond to the debate. Around 7 minutes, please, Great. Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I'd like to thank all of the members who've taken part in tonight's debate. The new model of neonatal intensive care recommended by the Best Start outlined that Scotland should move from the current model of 8 neonatal intensive care units to a model of 3 units supported by the continuation of current NICUs redesignated as local neonatal units. The evidence is clear that the highest risk babies are more likely to survive when they are cared for in units by clinicians who see more of these babies and with access to specialist support services. The Best Start report was underpinned by evidence. 8 evidence reviews were and are detailed in the Best Start report led by Professor Mary Renfrew of University of Dundee. Evidence is clear and set out in that report.
Graeme Simpson.
Can I thank the Minister for taking the intervention? She has heard repeatedly that the staff at Wishaw are performing to the highest level. It is that they are the best in the United Kingdom. Her argument doesn't stack up. Even at this late stage, is she prepared to say that she will pause the decision and have a rethink?
Minister.
So I thank the member for that intervention. I think I've been very clear that the decision has been based on clinical evidence by clinical experts. And that is evidence that we need to take account of. These born at highest risk are babies who are born at less than 27 weeks gestation, weigh less than 800 grams, or who need multiple complex intensive care interventions or surgery. It should be understood that no neonatal units were closed, and local neonatal units will continue to provide a level of neonatal intensive care for sick babies in their area. But the care for the most preterm and sickest babies will receive their specialist complex care in one of our specialist NICUs, and importantly return to their local area as soon as clinically appropriate. The process of determining which units should be providing neonatal intensive care followed an options appraisal process, which was undertaken by an expert group, including clinical leads and service user representatives. This model is supported by a range of stakeholders and clinicians, including Bliss, the leading charity for babies born premature or sick, who recognise that this new model of care is based on strong evidence and will improve the safety of services for the smallest and sickest babies.
Monica Lennon.
I'm very grateful, Minister. I do appreciate that a lot of this work started before you were in post as a minister. What steps have you taken now that it's on your desk to go back and check that everything is in line the way it should be? You've talked about the importance of clinicians, but what have you done to make sure that there was no one missing from that discussion? Because the information in my folder suggests that this process is flawed.
Minister.
I thank Monica Lennon for that intervention. When I came into post, I had a number of meetings with officials talking through this, and there was a review in 2022 of the decision of the outcomes that were made in 2019. As members will be aware, we currently have 15 incredible neonatal units in Scotland, each providing invaluable care for babies in their area. This will continue under the new model of care. The Best Start recommended that the new model of neonatal care should be based on the British Association of Perinatal Medicine definitions of levels of care. Neonatal units in Nine Wells in Dundee, the Princess Royal Maternity in Glasgow, Wishaw General, Victoria Hospital in Kirkcaldy and Crosshouse Hospital in Kilmarnock will continue to function as local neonatal units. And as I said in the previous debate, shifting from level a local neonatal unit has got more than actually a level 2 neonatal unit. And I would like to reassure members that under the new model, the scope of practice that a local neonatal unit can undertake means that the vast majority of babies who need neonatal care will still receive that locally. Local units will continue to provide a level of intensive care and will be able to care for all local babies born at greater than 27 weeks gestation. As members have highlighted today, the work that these units provide and will continue to provide is incredible. And hearing the words of parents who I have met and written to me detailing their experience has only reassured me that the care we are providing to the most vulnerable babies is inspirational. I'd like to take this second opportunity. I'd like to make some progress. Thank you. I would like to take the second opportunity to congratulate Wishaw General's neonatal multidisciplinary team in being named the UK Neonatal Team of the Year in 2023. I've also heard reference to Dr. Gray's, and if I can touch on that, Douglas Ross was correct. I did visit Dr. Gray's in Elgin in August. I was disappointed that Mr. Ross was unable to join me at these meetings because they were, from my perspective, very helpful, because I heard from Keep Mum and they were very clear in their concerns. And as I said in that meeting, I was very clear that 5 years was too long for this to happen, which is why I am pleased that the plan has now been agreed in March between NHS Highland and NHS Grampian. And when I met with the boards, we discussed what progress was being made. And as Mr. Ross will know, a project manager has been appointed. And I'd also like to point out that the Scottish Government has put £5 million to the refurbishment of Raigmore and also £5 million to Dr. Gray's. And I have written to both health boards requesting them to improve the timelines that they have said and also keep giving the Scottish Government more information.
Sorry, is the Minister giving way to Mr. Ross? Yes, Douglas Ross.
I'm grateful to the Minister for giving way, and I was also disappointed I couldn't meet with her, and I appreciated her officials contacting me and apologising for the late notice of the Minister's visit to Elgin. However, we can't just keep going round and round in circles and get more letters from the Government to the Health Board. The Government can instruct NHS Highland and NHS Grampian to ramp up their efforts, and there is real frustration that we are seeing little or no progress, and simply writing to them, urging them to do a bit more is not cutting the mustard. Indeed, Keep Mum has said at the moment they have little faith that our voices will be heard. Their voices are not being heard by the Government, NHS Grampian or NHS Highland, because if they were, we would see far more action on the ground right now to reinstate full consultant-led maternity services at Dr. Gray's.
Minister.
I thank Mr. Ross for his intervention. I think as I understand it, there was enough time for you to look at when the meeting was happening. We'd given you that notice actually earlier. I have been listening to Keep Mum, and I have been direct to the health boards as to what I expect them to be doing.
But we're seeing no progress.
And I think it's also, I'd like to make some progress, thank you. Also, Stranraer was mentioned by both Finlay Carson and Emma Harper, and that midwife service was temporarily withdrawn because of staffing. And as has been pointed out, there has been a review by Ayrshire and Arran, and the IGB are considering this, as I believe, at the end of September. They're meeting at the end of September. I'd like to make some progress. Thank you. In reference to the petition that's been highlighted today, I appreciate that local people will have concerns about the announced changes. I would like to clarify that these changes will affect a small number of families in Lanarkshire, and I appreciate that any family affected is probably one, is very difficult to cope with. I also wanted to highlight a range of other features of the new model of neonatal care outlined in the Best Start. This new model of care positions parents firmly as partners in their baby's care. It includes expansion of transitional care, allowing mothers and babies who need some additional neonatal support to stay together in a postnatal ward, improved facilities and support for payments, parents' expanded neonatal community care, allowing babies to get home sooner. Members will be aware that we've begun to address the financial concerns of parents with babies in neonatal care with the expansion of the Neonatal Expenses Fund, now known as the Young Patients Family Fund. The fund continues to help support many parents with the cost of travel, meals and accommodation whilst they are partners in the care of their babies. And I just suggest to Megan Gallagher, £8.50 is for meals, all travel is compensated in full. We are rolling out transitional care across Scotland and with all units on track to have this in place next year. In addition, all of our units are working towards implementation of the Bliss Baby Charter, with almost all units at silver or bronze level, two units having achieved gold standard and four more gold expected this year.
Minister, could I please ask you to bring your remarks to close?
Okay, so we will now work with all health boards affected to plan for and implement this service change over the course of the next year, informed by the testing that has been underway over the last few years. I'd like to, lastly, Presiding Officer, I'd like to thank everyone who has taken time to speak with us to inform our picture of what more needs to be done to reassure both the parents and the staff within our neonatal community. I'd like to thank all of those who have worked with us to look at how we can best deliver the changes recommended by the Best Start report. Their experience is invaluable in informing our approach to date. It will continue to be invaluable as we take forward our work, ensuring this government does as much as we possibly can to support those requiring neonatal care in Scotland.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes the debate, and I close this meeting.